Morning and welcome back to Baptist for Liberty. Today is July 11th, Friday, so it's our last program for this week. I'm your host, Joanna Works, and today I think we're just going to jump right back into our book club. We've been studying on New World Order, The Ancient Plan of Secret Societies by William T. Still, and just to recap, we looked at the Nixon coup was in the first chapter. And it was because of the author's father being approached to be a part of the Nixon coup that caused this reporter to start researching into conspiracy theories and secret societies. He uses the Nixon coup, I think, to introduce himself and his family's connection. Not that they wanted to be a part of the coup, but because a member of his family was approached, you know, it certainly makes it a little more personal than just whispers of a coup. Furthermore, he shows that in researching this, he saw that there were some inconsistencies. And so he had to keep doing research to try to figure out, to make sense of these inconsistencies. And there's things, you know, that came out in the media in that time during the 70s and afterwards, the coup attempt or the planning that never found fruition was primarily in October 1973. Of course, through the 70s, Nixon presidency is certainly something of interest to people, and in the 80s, more information on that came out, and so he gives dates and names of certain events and information that came out during congressional hearings almost or over 10 years after the fact. So, in his conclusion, he says that you have to go deeper and look at over 200 years of history to see how these things tie in together and make sense of these things. And, of course, I found it interesting because some of the conspiracy notions and things are still very... You hear about these sort of things even today. Oh, Obama's going to take over the presidency, or just overthrowing other governments. During Nixon's era, I believe it was Nicaragua that he mentioned. No, excuse me, the Chilean government was overthrown on September 11th, 1973, with aid of CIA. Then we moved on to the second chapter, and this one was ancient secret societies, and so he goes into the Masonry or Freemasonry. He delves into ancient Egyptian masonry, so this backtracks over 5,000 years, according to him, and what even masons of high degrees, what they have written in their books. He often quotes Manly Hall, who was a 33rd degree mason, and I think that's one of the highest, or if not the highest degree of masons. I mean, who knows? And you get in there might be degrees even higher that we don't know about. But anyway, he also talks about ancient symbols such as the eye and the sun and the magic star, numerical symbols. And then he discusses Illuminism, which is basically the real religion behind these secret societies, particularly Freemasonry. A man becomes God, and he ties it in with Gnosticism, which is very true, you know, Gnosticism, Illuminism, and, you know, even in the New Testament, there were people trying to pervert prophecies and scriptures and tie it into these Gnostic philosophies. And it talks about inner and outer doctrine. And I'm not going to go over all of this because we already discussed these and read highlights. I'm just glancing over this a little bit. And then in chapter 3, it was the Great Atlantean Plan, tying together the mythology of Atlantis and America, and the idea of turning America into the new Atlantis. They lost this one world government that they had at one point, and reestablishing it, beginning it anew in the Americas. And also, in the latter part of this chapter, he goes through the Sir Francis Bacon conspiracy and the notion that he actually wrote those things that William Shakespeare was given credit for. And what we haven't read yet was Chapter 4, Early American and Revolutionary and the Revolution, which I'm not going to read. It was an interesting chapter. It covers, I think, more Americans that were Masons, such as Benjamin Franklin and George Washington. I think one of the things I thought was interesting about that chapter was, or maybe it was in the next chapter, no, mentions Jefferson and the idea of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and how that's not actually a biblical concept, but it is a deist concept that is disguised to look Christian. And, you know, Jefferson was a deist, and he doesn't mention this yet, as far as I've read in his book so far, but Jefferson did write his own Bible, and so, you know, I liked a lot of Jefferson's quotes and some of the things he stood for when it comes to political things, but he wasn't a biblically grounded person. I really don't think there's any evidence that he was saved. I mean, it's possible that in his later years, or right before his death or something, that he came to the truth and repented of his sins, but there's no evidence of that I'm aware of. I mean, I could be wrong, I'm just saying. What we do know is that he was a deist, and he had the audacity to write his own Bible, filled with his own personal philosophies, which, you know, probably came from his actual Masonry and secret society. The Illuminati, as in the actual organization, the Illuminati. One of the things he already established earlier in the book was there's a difference between Illuminism as a religion and the particular organization, the Illuminati. So, in Chapter 5, he deals with the history of the Illuminati. It was founded by a German, and I'm not going to pronounce his name right, Adam Weishaupt, Weishaupt, and he organized this in 1776, so the same year that the Revolutionary War started, the Illuminati was founded. And one of the things he brings up is this man was the founder of the Illuminati, so he was as much a father of communism as Karl Marx. Karl Marx, he wasn't the originator of communism, it's just, I guess, his articulation and how he codified these socialist concepts. It gained popularity, I guess his articulation of it was well enough that it just clicked, you know. Maybe it was just the time period, different things, you know, because other people had been before him, that it just stuck. After Marx, some of the tenets that he lists here, tenets of the Illuminati are then summarized in the following 5 points. Abolition of monarchies and all ordered government. Abolition of private property and inheritances. Abolition of patriotism and nationalism. Abolition of family life and the institution of marriage and the establishment of communal education of children. And the last one, abolition of all religion. And we see some of these planks, you know, these are the very things that we're fighting over even today. Ordered government, I mean, we see fighting and revolutions all over the world. Right now in particular would be the Middle East and Africa that stirring up of strife. And it's not just, you know, black people can't get along with black people. There's a lot of other politics. There's still a lot of promotion of these things by outside countries. I mean, they're not still colonies technically, but there's still a lot of outside forces stirring up one group against another, as well as any internal issues. I don't want to downplay one over the other, because they're both critically important, you know, the internal and the external problems. And we see Iraq, you know, the U.S., we were going to set them straight, give them democracy. Well, democracy is mob rule, and it always leads to chaos, and somebody has to eventually come on top. That's why the U.S. was not supposed to be a democracy. It was supposed to be a republic with some democratic elements. Republic is rule of law. There's more on the concept of perfecting Christianity, which in really means just turning Christianity on its head. You lure people in with biblical sounding ideas, and then as they get deeper into it, turn them into deists, and then you turn them into outright Satanists. Yeah. Okay, so that's chapter 5. And there was, I think, a section. There was one little bit here I did want to read. In April 1785, four other Illuminati who were also professors left the society, disgusted by Weshlip and his tyrannical order. They were summoned before a court of inquiry to give an account of the doctrines and methods of the order. The evidence presented by these men left no further room for doubt concerning the diabolical nature of Illuminism. Their testimony revealed a sweeping scope. So this is the downfall of the Illuminati party. You know, here it was established in 1776, but it's starting to come to an end in 1785 as a cohesive organization. And it's mostly because of internal struggle, and certain ones decided. As far as the testimony, it would sound like they were above this, that they didn't want to have any parts, and just how far the leaders of the Illuminati wanted to take it. I'm a skeptic. And I don't know if perhaps it was more somebody was going down and they were going to take others down with them, or maybe it was just a power play within the organization. But what they had testified, here's a quote: "All religion, all of a country, and loyalty to sovereigns were to be annihilated. Every effort was to be made to create disorder, not only between princes and their subjects, but even between parents and children. While suicide was to be encouraged by inculcating in men's minds the idea that the act of killing oneself afforded a certain voluptuous pleasure." That quote, when I read it, not that long ago, we were talking about how suicide, I was having a talk with a couple different people on how suicide has become just not necessarily acceptable, but in our daily news, it's even, you know, preachers who commit suicide, and I don't think they did it because of, they thought it was something pleasurable, but, you know, the depression, hopelessness, a feeling of hopelessness, doesn't mean that they're not godly people. It's just in that moment Satan found them weak enough. And in this, you know, to take it even so far, it's not even just depression, but oh yeah, dying is pleasurable. I mean, in the Gospels we know that if you're saved, you're going to be with the Lord, and even Paul said, you know, absent from the body is presence with the Lord, and that is a rejoiceful thing. But when you have work to do here on earth, and your pleasure and rejoicing is that you're going to be with God when God calls you home, not when you call yourself home. And there's rejoicing to be made in doing God's work here. I mean, it's tiresome. It's draining, both physically and emotionally. It can just be the most challenging thing. But that doesn't mean it's not without rewards or rejoicing. Another book I've been reading for ladies' Bible studies on the fruit of the Spirit by Brother Tom Ross. And just this last month, at our Bible study, we were on the chapter on joy. And joy is not, it's a steadiness. It isn't this wavering like an emotion such as happiness. It's steady. It's a constant. It's there even when you're feeling sad. You can still rejoice and have joy in your heart because of God's salvation. Because, you know, if you're one of his little ones, he died on the cross for you. And he knows every heartache. And he's there alongside you with everyone. I mean, what did he say before he left? That he was sending a comforter. He didn't leave us without hope. He didn't leave us without joy. And another one, the fruit of the spirits, is peace. And, you know, we're reading these chaotic things, whether it's in the news or even crazy books like this, and I'm not saying it's the book necessarily is like crackpot type crazy. I'm just saying it can drive you crazy choosing to study any of these things. But we have peace from the Lord. We have hope. We have joy. We have everything that possibly need to rejoice in. And we just need to make sure that we're not taking those things for granted, that we're not taking the Lord for granted. I know, like, I find it fascinating to read these things, to study them, but it has to be tempered with the reading of the scriptures. It has to be tempered with putting things into proper perspective. A lot of people don't like reading Revelations because it's depressing, it's sad. When I read it, I do feel a sadness for those who are going to be cast into the lake of fire. I do feel a sense of hopelessness for those who go through the tribulation. And because for a lot of them, once they reach the great throne of judgment, that's it. It's over. Their time of hope, their opportunity to repent, their opportunity to be saved, that's gone. I mean, and we do know that it's all of the Lord, that no man seeks after him, that no one would repent. It's not in our nature to repent, except for the working of the Holy Spirit and his amazing grace. And that's all we can lean on. And so when you read Revelation, it's like, okay, I deserve to be at that great white throne of judgment. But I know I'm not going to fall into any condemnation because of the Lord's salvation. Because he elected me. He chose me. Many are called, but few are chosen. He draws us to himself. Even in this life, when we see wars and rumors of wars, a lot of people are excited because the end times are coming. And yes, that's good. That's to be called home soon. But the other side of that means to work all the more diligently, to pray all the more, to draw closer to our church families, to our brothers and sisters in Christ, to lift one another up, to witness to the outside, to the lost world. This is our mission field. The whole world is our mission field wherever we are. And as we see these mind-boggling things happening, or things that seems completely contradictory to one another, and we can't make sense of it, we already know God already has, he understands it, and he's going to get us through it, and he hasn't left us to be idle. We have things to do. Anyway, I just felt like going on that for a little bit, just all these tragic sounding things. I'm thinking about what to cover in the broadcast today or tomorrow or whatnot. And it's like, well, I can cover this news story or I can cover that news story. And it's just like, it's so weary. It's like, no, I don't think I want to do that one. Maybe not. I still need to study this one out more before I talk about it. This, that, or the other. But anyway, I'm just going to glance over a little bit. Chapter 6 is on the French Revolution. And I'll just read, Professor Douglas Johnson, in his 1970 book, The French Revolution, remarked that the 18th century had not been bad for France. The population was expanded, there had been no great plagues, and no wars had been fought on French soil. The French people loved their monarch. No signs of disloyalty to it could be detected. We see in the French Revolution the first time where grievances were systematically created in order to exploit them. Most history texts tell us that the French Revolution of the late 1700s was a popular uprising sparked by a starving population, rioting in protest of a bankrupt government. We are also told that fewer than 50,000 lives were lost. The truth is, however, that the revolution was deliberately contrived by the machinations of the secret societies rampant in France at that time, and the death toll was at least 300,000. The French Revolution was the first example of what we would later come to know as Soviet-style revolutionary communism, as Russia's revolutionary leader, Prince Peter Kropotkin, wrote in 1908, the Great Revolution, as he called it, was the source and origin of all the present communist, anarchist, and socialist conceptions. Some of America's founding fathers were equally enthralled with the Great Revolution, becoming caught up in the popular Masonic fervor for liberty at any cost. John Marshall, Chief Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court from 1801 to 1835, stated that in no other part of the globe was this revolution hailed with more joy than in America. And it goes on a little bit more. Of course, this was just the opening remarks, some of the opening remarks for this chapter. I think I'm going to skip down to this paragraph on Jacobin clubs. After the recent exposures in Bavaria, the Illuminati had been driven even further underground, taking on a variety of names, such as the French Revolutionary Club. As radicals flocked into these new varieties of Illuminism, a larger meeting hall was needed. The hall of the Jacobins convent was leased, and it was from this hall that they eventually derived their new name, the Jacobin Club. The Jacobin Club met in secret and eventually boasted of having some of the best educated and most influential men in France among its 1,300 members. The Jacobins vowed to destroy the monarchy as well as other existing institutions and sought to establish what they called a New World Order or Universal Republic. In order to achieve proper revolutionary zeal, the Jacobins began searching for an issue to justify revolution. Soon they came upon the formula that has been used in most revolutions since then. First, they encourage a lawlessness through a group of radical thugs. Then their more influential members raise a strident call for law and order, and thousands of Frenchmen were sent to the guillotine. This set the stage with an atmosphere of repression. And you do see that. I mean, just think about that. Those steps: cause problem, demand order, and then persecute. Just slaughter whoever it is that you pointed the finger at, whoever was easiest to identify as the problem, as those who called for order find themselves in higher and higher levels of power. Yeah. You want order? You want rule and law? That last statement isn't to disenfranchise the whole concept, but you do have to be leery of those. The very fervent ones calling for law and order, and what is their concept of it? What does that entail? To what lengths will you go to gain that? And who will you leave in control? I mean, who are you seeking to put in charge of that rule and order? For some reason, my mind had just wandered back to the Old Testament and the people, you know, they'd been under the judges, and everybody did what was right in their own eyes, and that wasn't working out too well for them. I mean, in the spiritual sense, it meant that no, they weren't living, behaving themselves as according to God's word, and justify themselves. But then they look around and they see the nations around them, and they're mighty and they're strong, and you know, they have kings, and this is why they're mighty and they're strong, and they wanted to be like that. So they demanded a king. And the prophet Samuel, you know, this, he was awfully grieved by this. And God told him, you know, it's not you that they've rejected. It's me. They rejected God. And the Lord told Samuel what to do. And so Samuel told them, okay, you choose among you who you want to have king, but this is what's going to happen. Men, the young men, are going to be called and make a mighty army. Your women, you know, they're going to be called up and they're going to be used for the king's purposes, you know. And basically he prophesied, you know, yeah, you're going to have a powerful nation, but there's going to be consequences of this, because when you demand to be powerful as a nation, the reality of it is not pleasant for those who have to live in it. And that's just the facts. Now, a lot of people are demanding that America stays great, that America stays number one. Why? What happened to meekness? What happened to humbleness? What happened to the fruits of the Spirit? I mean, even Christians demanding that, well, America, you know, we're losing our place in the world. Okay, so what? Jesus said that the least will be greatest. And the great, you know, who a lot of people consider the greatest, guess what? They're going to be the least. So why clamor for that seat of power, for that that finest place at the table? You know, whether it's in our individual lives or as a nation, or when we look to leaders, why do we demand a powerful leader? You know, he who governs least governs best. That, you know, that's what we need. We need leaders who show meekness. And meekness is not weakness. I had a pastor who said that when he was preaching through the fruit of the spirits a few years ago. And I love that phrase. And it's totally true. Meekness is not weakness. Jesus was meek. Jesus tells his children to be meek. But we're strong in him. You know, and so we can apply humility to both our individual lives, of course, but also as a nation. I think as a nation, we've completely wrapped up ourselves in national pride, and we're tearing ourselves apart, trying to be at that table of greatest honor, at the seat of the greatest honor, you know, among all the other nations. Forget it. That's not what we need to focus on. That's what secret societies seek. They seek to be the greatest, to be the most powerful, to join all these nations together in one government, and to prove that they're mightier than God himself. Think about that. And we know from Revelations that, yeah, one world government, it's going to happen. And, you know, it's not going to be pretty. And, of course, it's not going to last very long. In the overall scheme of things, it's not going to last very long. And then we'll have, you know, the king of the universe, who has been king all along, but we've refused to obey him. And he's going to come and he's going to sit on his throne. What a day. That'll be good. Of course. I mean, that's That would be good. That's too much of an understatement. But I think that's a good note to leave off on today. Okay, so we're going to be reading our Proverbs chapter 11 today. I know, today was just kind of me, like, just using that book more of a jumping off point to ramble on a couple of things, I guess. I didn't know I was going to do that. Just kind of happened. Alright, so Proverbs chapter 11. A false balance is abomination to the Lord, but a just weight is his delight. When pride cometh, then cometh shame, but with the lowly is wisdom. The integrity of the upright shall guide them, but the perverseness of transgressors shall destroy them. Riches profit not in the day of wrath, but righteousness delivereth from death. The righteousness of the perfect shall direct his way, but the wicked shall fall by his own wickedness. The righteousness of the upright shall deliver them, but transgressors shall be taken in their own naughtiness. When a wicked man dieth, his expectation shall perish, and the hope of unjust men perisheth. The righteous is delivered out of trouble, and the wicked cometh in his stead. An hypocrite with his mouth destroyeth his neighbor, but through knowledge shall the just be delivered. When it goeth well with the righteous, the city rejoiceth, and when the wicked perish, there is shouting. By the blessing of the upright, the city is exalted, but it is overthrown by the mouth of the wicked. He that is void of wisdom despiseth his neighbor, but a man of understanding holdeth his peace. A talebearer revealeth secrets, but he that is of a faithful spirit concealeth the matter. Where no counsel is, the people fall, but in the multitude of counselors there is safety. He that is surety for a stranger shall smart for it, and he that hateth suretyship is sure. A gracious woman retaineth honor, and strong men retain riches. The merciful man doth good to his own soul, but he that is cruel troubleth his own flesh. The wicked worketh a deceitful work, but to him that soweth righteousness shall be a sure reward. As righteousness tendeth to life, so he that pursueth evil pursueth it to his own death. They that are of a froward heart are abomination to the Lord, but such as are upright in their way are his delight. Though hand join in hand, the wicked shall not be unpunished, but the seed of the righteous shall be delivered. As a jewel of gold and a swine's snout, so is a fair woman which is without discretion. The desire of the righteous is only good, but the expectation of the wicked is wrath. There is that scattereth and yet increaseth, and there is that withholdeth more than is meet, but it tendeth to poverty. The liberal soul shall be made fat, and he that watereth shall be watered also himself. He that withholdeth corn, the people shall curse him, but blessing shall be upon the head of him that selleth it. He that diligently seeketh good procureth favor, but he that seeketh mischief, it shall come unto him. He that trusteth in his riches shall fall, but the righteous shall flourish as a branch. He that troubleth his own house shall inherit the wind, and the fool shall be servant to the wise of heart. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise. Behold, the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth, much more the wicked and the sinner.